Hello everyone, I want to welcome you into today's presentation that I titled Groundwater Treatment for Bottled Water Production. My name is Omeja Maxwell. I am a water quality and environmental expert from Department of Physics, Geophysics Option, Covenant University of Utah. This is my mobile number, these are my email addresses. So we are going to discuss step by step on how to treat water that is sourced from the groundwater, that's borehole, into production process to become bottled water. That's why we titled it Groundwater Treatment Plant for Bottled Water Production. Now, the water is sourced from the borehole with the help of submersible pump. Once the water is pushed out of this place, the first thing is for water analysis to be conducted in a quality lab that all the processes of quality assurance or quality control is maintained. So once the result comes out, it is expected that the design configuration for water treatment will follow this process for standard operation procedure. Now, the water flows from the borehole, enters into this 5 micron. This 5 micron will remove the debris that are coming from this borehole. So once it removes it, the particles that are from 5 microns and above will be trapped, whereas the ones lesser than that will flow. Once the water comes into this, look at the way it splashes into this tank. As soon as it comes, the water is being interacted with the air that constitutes oxygen. Oxygen serves as an oxidant. It removes methane from the raw water. It removes hydrogen sulfide that constitutes rotten egg smell. It removes dissolved iron and manganese, and as well high content of carbon dioxide, because high content of carbon dioxide is always found in borehole water. So once such is done with the help of oxygen as an oxidant, the water is pumped out of this place with the help of 0.5 horsepower surface pump. The water moves straight, then 1 micron filter will remove the debris that will be coming from this oxidized water here. So, and the ones below 1 micron will flow. Once it comes into this tank, this is where primary treatment with chemicals starts. First and foremost, we suggest chlorine. And as we suggest chlorine, we have to be very careful to monitor trihalomethane. We monitor it with the help of pH. So once the pH of the water here is properly monitored, then we will be able to maintain and monitor trihalomethane, which is very dangerous. It is carcinogenic. So that's why we have to be very, very careful. So we calculate the chlorine with those here, which is chlorine demand. We calculate it with the help of the length times the width with the volume of this tank with the constituent of the water that pollutes the water. So once we calculate the amount of contaminants in the water and the amount of chlorine to be dosed, which is chlorine demand, that will be able to help us to add or dose the chlorine that will be sufficient enough to oxidize all the oxidizable materials here. Now, once such quantity of chlorine is added, then 0.5 milligram per liter concentration of chlorine is required to handle microbial. So whatever value you get to be added as chlorine demand, 0.5 milligram per liter concentration is required to handle microbial. So once such is done, then this valve will be opened and allow the water to flow. Once it comes to this point, this is a sampling point where some parameters will be measured. Total dissolved solid, will be measured. Total organic carbon will be measured. Bio-oxygen demand will be measured. pH will be measured. Alkalinity will be measured. And oxidation reduction potential will be measured. If everything is in order, the water is allowed to flow from here while this valve is closed. The water is allowed to flow with the help of this 1 horsepower surface pump. Now, why do we have 1 horsepower here and at this point we have 0.5 horsepower? The reason is that if you look at the flow process to this point, we only have one resistance here. But here we have so much resistances that require much higher capacity to be able to push the water through. So once the water is pushed to this point, the 1 micron filter will remove the debris from this point and allow the water to flow into this sand filter. Now, how does this sand filter work? It works this way. The down part of it is loaded with fine sand. The middle part of it is loaded with fine to coarse. The topmost is loaded with coarse. And space is to be maintained here so that the pressure will be balanced. If the pressure is not balanced, it will be crushing the sand inside this cylinder to be more thinner that can flow through this process. So that's why bed depth law is supposed to be maintained here so that the normal pressure will be in order. So once the water comes in here, these 2 valves will be closed. Then these 2 valves will be opened. So the water comes, flows through this way, enters into this media. As it enters into this media, the filtered water comes out here and flows through this way. It can't go back because this valve is closed. It will now flow through this way. So sampling point is this point. When you want to sample here, you close these 2 valves here so that this water cannot enter. So once this valve is opened, then water sample is to be collected at this point. You test for turbidity, you test for total organic carbon, you test for pH, you test for ORP and alkalinity as well. So why do we test for turbidity? Because the water coming here will be turbid. So this will remove turbidity, it will remove particles that are from 5 micron size and above, and it will also handle some pathogens as well. So if everything is in order, you close this valve, this water will flow. Coming into this carbon filter, it will meet carbon loaded inside this. The same configuration of flow, you close this valve, you open these 2 valves. So the water comes in, flows here, enters into this valve. So now as it enters into this water filter that is loaded with carbon, so the carbon removes color, it removes dust, it removes odor, and as well removes residual oxidant, residual chlorine that is used here. This one does not handle it, this one removes it. So and once it is done, the water will flow coming to this point. This will remove the debris that will be coming from this, then water analysis is supposed to be done here. This is the critical point too. So collect water samples, test for residual chlorine, test for pH, test for TDS, test for ORP, test for alkalinity. After everything, the water is allowed to enter into softener. So what does softener do? Softener removes the 2 strongest electrolytes, calcium and magnesium, that constitute water hardness. So, and the softener is loaded with resin coated with zeolite. The resin is charged or regenerated with 2 strongest salts, sodium chloride salt and potassium chloride salt. Either of them can be used. In most cases, I suggest sodium chloride salt. When sodium chloride salt is used to regenerate the bed, it will be fully charged. The chloride ion will be trapping the calcium and magnesium ion. So this is an ion exchange resin bed. So this bed traps calcium and magnesium so that the water that will come out here will be completely soft water. The same configuration in the sense that the The water comes in here. These two valves are closed. These two are open. It flows in here, goes in and comes out here. So once it comes to this point, the water comes. This will remove debris. Then this point, this is another critical point that you're supposed to collect water sample to test for total hardness, to be sure that the calcium and magnesium ions are already trapped inside this, so that the water, hard water coming in here will be soft at this point. So once all those things are done at this point, and you discover that the water is, the load of the pollutants or contaminants are reduced, we suggest a ultrafiltration machine. If those things are not reduced, we suggest reverse osmosis purifier. Reverse osmosis purifier will help to remove, if we still have carbonate and bicarbonate constituents in the water and some other inorganic constituents, reverse osmosis will completely demineralize or deionize the water completely. So once it demineralizes the water, remember the water will be more or less distilled water, which is not always good for the system. So how does RO purify water? In RO, it constitutes two multi-stage pumps. The first one is the inlet pressure pump. This multi-stage pump proper is the one that supplies the normal range of pressure water that goes into the membrane film. Inside the membrane film, it is partitioned into two, where water enters. It will either go in through the permit, which will be purified, or it will be rejected through the brine, and brine will be recycled again and come back to be purified. So that's how, once it crosses the purified or the permit, then that means it has passed the semi-permeable membrane. So that semi-permeable membrane is the complete deionizer or demineralizer. So once water passes through there, it will have been demineralized, and the total dissolved solid or TDS is expected to be very, very small or even zero at that point. So once it is done, then this is a critical point where it tests for the TDS to know whether the water is completely demineralized or deionized. If such is done, you allow the water to flow, come to this point, remove, in case if there's any debris, it removes this with 1 micron filter. Then this valve will be open, the water will now come in here. Once the water coming into the secondary treatment tank, we suggest ozone at this point. Why do we suggest ozone at this point? We suggest ozone because the contact time is very small, 4 minutes to 10 minutes. Within 4 minutes to 10 minutes, it will have finished oxidized all the oxidizable materials, unlike chlorine that takes from 30 minutes to 24 hours. And as well, ozone is the best oxidant because the residual does not have any side effects, unlike this, that the byproduct trihalomethane is carcinogenic. So if pH is not properly monitored, it will be very, very dangerous. So how do we generate ozone that we use here? This is an ozonator. This ozonator extracts oxygen from the atmosphere. Once the oxygen is extracted from the atmosphere and enters into oxygen chamber, the oxygen chamber will filter other elements like nitrogen and discard them away, then allow only O2 in. The O2, which is oxygen, will be broken into O1 with the help of high voltage of about 360 volts. After breaking it into O1, it will now be pushed down into ozone chamber, where the O1 will recombine to form O3. After forming O3, the water will now be, the ozone will now be generated completely. So at this point, you close this valve here, you open this valve here, the generated ozone will now be injected into this tank. So after injecting ozone here, it will, within 4 minutes, it will have finished its contact time, oxidize whatever that is in this water. Then 1 horsepower surface pump is allowed to push the water in into pH adjuster. Why do we use pH adjuster? pH adjuster introduces minerals that are needful or that are needed in the system, because the water that comes from RO is completely demineralized. So this will inject a known concentration of calcium, a known concentration of zinc, a known concentration of copper into the water to adjust the pH from acidic range to alkaline range that is suitable for consumption, which is from 7.2 to 8.5. Good water that is in alkaline range should be between 7.2 and 8.5. So once such is maintained here, the water passes through this 1 micron filter, passes through this 0.5 micron filter, then passes through this absolute filter, which is 0.2 micron. Once it is done, then we introduce UV light. This UV light is a sterilizer. It sterilizes the water in case there is any contaminants along this flow. So, and we suggest UV light of wavelength that of this range of 200 to 225 nanometer range. It is safer. Its efficiency is very, very high. It decontaminates and sterilizes the water completely without any side effects. So that's why we suggest the range of UV of that point. So once it is done, we introduce ozone at this point again, because the residual ozone that is coming from here, once it is being struck or heated, once it's heated with UV light, the O3 will go back and form O2, which will constitute favorable growth for bacteria to grow within this point. So once we hit the UV light at this point, we introduce ozone up front again. We cannot bring ozone here, because once it crosses through this UV light, it will make favorable growth at this point. A favorable condition for growth will be at this point, because converting the O3 to O2 will make bacteria to grow within this point. So once ozone is injected online through this point, then we allow 0.2 milligram per liter concentration of ozone to enter into this tertiary treatment tank. And this is where we call ozonation point, where the water will now be allowed. After critical point, at this point, we check for residual oxidant, which is ozone that will be bottled to be 0.2 milligram per liter concentration, because the water that is bottled supposed to last for 1 year. So with the help of 0.2 milligram per liter concentration of ozone, it will now help to prevent and protect the water for such a long time. The 0.5 horsepower pump will now help to push the water through this 0.2 micron and enters into treated water or freshness tank. From this point, the water will now be pushed to the production room. Now, this is a full complete reverse osmosis water purifier machine, not yet opened. We install this for water production. Now, this is where I was assembling the reverse osmosis with the stainless filter. These are the stainless filters. I'm assembling this, trying to connect this to this point, so that after filtration, it will be able to pass through the reverse osmosis. This is where we put the practical aspect of what we have explained up there. So this is where I'm making the connections to be sure that everything is in order. That's the installation of reverse osmosis water purifier, to be sure that everything is in order. The normal voltage is supplied, and the normal pressure gauges within the machine is in order. So this is where I'm monitoring the knobs to be sure that the pressure ranges in PSI here are in order. That's why I said examining the switches of the reverse osmosis water purifier. Then this is where the full treatment, this is where I am monitoring the flow line to be sure that at this point there are no issues with these knobs, these valves, so that everything will have a normal flow process, so that there will be no backflow or anything that will damage the flow line. So this is the full complete treatment. This is the sand filter, this is the carbon filter, this is the softener. So the way I explained it over there, this is the practical aspect of it along the line. So this is Timmy. Then from that point, treatment section to the bottled water production room. So this is the bottled water production room with the full or complete bottle line. This complete bottle line, automatic bottle line. The bottles are put at this point it will automatically carry the bottles coming to this point. It will wash, the water, the bottle here, rinse it twice before allowing the bottle to come to this filling point. This filling point, it will now be filled at this point and as well capped at this point. This is the labeling point. This is the shrink packer that shrinks the label within the bottle, on the bottle surface. This is the already produced water, bottled water produced for public consumption. Thanks for your attention.